Today, the audience's reaction feels surreal. This is the legendary presentation of the first iPhone by Steve Jobs in 2007. The elegant slide to unlock gesture was meant to solve the problem of accidental presses. That was the official version, but it's only half the truth, the lesser half. The second deeper purpose was to build a habit of using gestures of controlling the phone with your thumb while it's in your hand. And it was this that unlocked a whole new era of human-computer interaction. You probably remember that slide to unlock has long been a thing of the past, but that's not true. Today, you unlock your iPhone with a swipe up from the bottom, a direct descendant of that original slide to unlock. To understand how this specific gesture and this particular piece of interface had such a massive impact on everything, and more importantly, to figure out the consequences of that impact in our modern world, let's break down how it was designed both from the phone side and, more importantly, from our side of the interface, inside our brains. To begin, let's just take a close look at how it was designed. Why does it feel so right? The answer is affordance. It's a property of an object that suggests how it should be used, without instructions. Look at this slide bolt. Its shape screams, slide me horizontally. It sits in a groove, it has a handle, and it's pressed against one edge. We don't need a manual to understand how it works, and this kind of approach can change the very nature of a specific design, turning it from a UX solution into a cultural virus. Now back to the slider. It's the exact same principle. First, the block itself is three-dimensional. It looks like a physical object you can grab and move. Second, it rests in a depression, a track which clearly defines its path of motion. Third, there's a gap between the block and the walls, hinting at its freedom of movement. And finally, it's pressed against the left edge. It's in its initial state, waiting for an action. Our bodies, our brains, have learned over millennia of evolution to read such physical cues instantly. This is the first part of the design's genius. It doesn't speak to our conscious mind, it speaks to our reflexes. But Apple knew they had no room for error. The launch of a product that was supposed to change the world was at stake. So they didn't rely on intuition alone. On top of this perfect affordance, they added three more layers of explicit instructions. A triple check system. First, the arrow, the most universal symbol for direction on the planet. Second, the text. A direct command, slide to unlock, which leaves no room for interpretations. And the third is the most elegant. This shimmer, a wave of light that runs from left to right. It's not an instruction, but a hint. And when we perform the action, we get a reward. A smooth animation confirming our success, and a quiet but incredibly important click sound with haptic feedback. And just like that, a dozen tiny thoughtful details come together to create a flawless experience. Speaking of thoughtful tools that help create such experiences, in my studio Dello, we often work on complex challenges developing the philosophy for a future product, its design foundation. In the past, to present these concepts, I would prepare a multi-page PDF media kit. It was static and frankly boring. But today I can do this. I build this small presentation site for the channel using Readdy.ai. It has an integrated AI agent that doesn't just answer questions, it provides value. Let me show you. Imagine a potential partner wants to know if their brand is a good fit for my audience.
Hi, this is Design Lovers. I'm your scheduling assistant. It is now a good time to talk. How can I assist you today?
Hi, can you describe the channel's audience?
Sure. Design Lovers' audience includes design professionals, creative directors, and design enthusiasts. They enjoy in-depth culture and human experience. Would you like to know more about our services?
See? No generic answers. The agent pulls specific key data directly from my media kit. But it's not just about providing information. It's about turning that interest into a real conversation.
That's a very impressive audience. How can I get more details, data, and discuss the next steps?
Thank you. We create high-quality, narrative-driven content featuring iconic designs, emerging trends, and creative minds shaping the visual world. Would you like to book an appointment to talk more about this?
That would be great.
Yes, my website moves the conversation forward on its own. The agent finds an open slot, confirms the call, and sends notifications. All of this works perfectly on mobile too, and the new lead is already waiting for me in the admin panel. No manual work required. For me, as a creator, this is the future. Technology should free up our time from routine tasks for what's most important, creating ideas. So if you want to present your projects just as easily or automate your communication, give Readdy.ai a try. The link is, as always, in the description and in the pinned comment. Getting back to the slider and its analysis. The final question I always ask after an analysis like this is, why does it ultimately work? And in the case of this slider, why did it hack our brains so easily and so deeply? And if you think hack is too strong a word, and really, what's there to learn from slide to unlock? Let me answer you from the past, from the year 2003. That year, I was teaching computer skills to adult women in their 40s. For them, it was a completely new world. And guess what the first fundamental problem we faced was? What action, which we consider elementary today, turned out to be an almost insurmountable barrier for them? Here's a hint, it has to do with the mouse. Seriously, pause the video, think about it, and write your guess in the comments. Clicking the mouse. They would perfectly position the cursor over the start button, but the moment they pressed the left mouse button, their hand would make an involuntary micro movement. The cursor would shift just enough to miss and the click would go into empty space, again and again. What seems completely natural to us often has a steep learning curve. Our bodies weren't born to press small plastic buttons, so even an action simpler than slide to unlock can sometimes have a learning curve, however small. And the depth of that learning curve is determined by the structure of our brain. This is a two-way process. We change interfaces, and if they become successful as cultural units, as memes in the Dawkins sense, then the interfaces change us. Imagine we have two systems. The first is for abstract commands. Press Ctrl+C, enter password, click the icon. This system requires a translation, a conscious effort. Even signs like push or pull belong to this realm. And then there's a second system, ancient, powerful. It's the library of motor memory. It's responsible for physical gestures, wiping crumbs off a table, turning a page. These actions don't require thought, the body just knows what to do. Slide to unlock goes directly to this second, faster system. It didn't ask us to learn a new command. It invited us to perform a familiar physical action. And a perfectly designed interface can be identified by what psychologists call the familiarity effect. It's that deep emotional response when something new feels uniquely right, as if it was always meant to be that way. All these details combined with the fact that the iPhone became a global phenomenon and influence either directly or through its followers, countless other phones with the same mechanics resulted in an anthropological experiment on a global scale. So what happens when a global anthropological experiment is deemed a success? It stops being an experiment. It becomes the new norm, a new habitat. When our ancestors left Africa, it wasn't just the ground beneath their feet that changed. They themselves changed. The terrain changed their gait, the landscape changed their hunting methods, the length of the day changed their sleep. They adapted to the new environment culturally, and at the same time, the new environment shaped them through natural selection. Smartphones fortunately don't create conditions for natural selection, but in every other respect, it's a direct analogy. We voluntarily migrated into a digital habitat, formed a global culture, and that culture in turn influences each of us. Slide to unlock gave birth to a new model of behavior. In the era of feature phones, extra steps held us back. Now interaction has been simplified to its absolute core. The phone became an extension of the hand, always ready to deliver a dose of dopamine on demand. We don't even notice ourselves doing it. We just act on autopilot. The familiarity of the swipe is a demonstration of our species' greatest superpower, cultural evolution. Unlike slow biological evolution, which needs millennia, culture allows us to change within a single generation. It allows billions of people to almost instantly agree on a new language of gestures, and that is astonishing. But this speed has a dark side. In the last few years, we have been changing again, very quickly. But these changes are no longer synchronous. The culture that united all of us with a single gesture yesterday is now dividing us into opposing camps. We see the world through a lens of us versus them, because our cultural codes are updating at different speeds and in different directions, creating ever-increasing tension between the poles. And this is no one's fault. It's simply a feature of our operating system. While I was making this video, I thought about how profoundly culture changes our behavior and how little it changes our essence, the one that was forged by millions of years of true slow evolution. If you want to keep seeing these patterns before everyone else, the hidden forces shaping interfaces and the way they reshape us, I send a weekly email. It's designed to make you the person in the room who understands why things work, not just what works. The link is in the description.